visiting. We want to welcome you, invite you to be back with us at any time that you can. Consider us to be your church home and let us become part of your family. If you're part of our YouTube family, we want to welcome you. It's good to have you with us. Invite you to come if you can and be part of our services. This morning's youth leader is Miss Hannah, and looks like Brent must have got called out this morning, so 12 and under. I'd like to go over for Children's Church. Invite you to go over for that. And while they're doing that, if you want to go ahead and mark number 51, Lord, I'm Coming Home, we'll use the first and the third verses of that hymn for our hymn of invitation this morning. As you remember, hopefully, and maybe if you don't remember, I'll remind you, last week we started a series about words with great power. If you remember A.D. Williams's quote, words have great power, the power to heal, the power to help, the power to heal, and the power to hurt. Use this power carefully. Last week we looked first at love, if you recall, and a couple of examples out of Scripture. We learned the four types of love as it's described in the Greek language, comparing that to our one word that we have in the English language. And hopefully you learned to differentiate a little bit after hearing those descriptions or definitions, that you began to use your language a little bit different in how you describe things. Well, this morning we're going to look at another word with great power, and that word is adopted. Most of us, of course, know the meaning of the word adopted, but just for the sake of consistency, the definition is to take into one's family through legal means and to raise as one's own child. Now, let's take just a moment and consider about what it would be like to maybe put ourselves in the shoes of an orphan. Many times, that would be the case. Now, several years ago, a child would be considered an orphan because of both parents have passed away, or maybe an incarceration. But today, we know that to be more on the incarceration part and due to the drug use. Sadly, today, children are orphaned because of the parents' choices, not because of the death so much. But could you imagine being in this world without a mom or a dad? How that you might feel that you weren't loved. How that you certainly may not have the human touch of the hug of a mom. Certainly you may feel that you're unnoticed. And it sounds like to me, though I can't identify with it, I can have sympathy for it. It's a situation that has little hope. Carol and I were at a send-off party for a young man leaving tomorrow to go to his basic training in AIT, and his parents fostered children. And I got just a little glimpse of what it may be like to be an orphan as he was describing a young man that they fostered in their home for several years. And I think he's living in Cincinnati, and he had come back to celebrate or to well wish his step or his friend. I guess he probably considered him more like a brother. But he said whenever they brought him into their home the first few days, he said every day that he would get off of the school bus, he would ask, "Am I sleeping here tonight?" So that young man had no idea, no sense of place. And that's what and why it's important that we understand the power the word adopt has. If you will, turn in your Bibles to Romans 8. That's where we was last week, if you recall. We're going to continue to use Paul's letter to the Romans and see about this word adopted. Because God wants to have that kind of relationship with us. He wants to be our Father. And not only our Father, but a Father. You know, there's a difference. that's what I want to kind of differentiate. We're going to look, it's a short passage this morning, Romans chapter 8, verses 14 through 17. We'll read that, then we'll go in to look at some things. He says, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together." And that's why I want to look at this morning four things about that word adoption. And how it should, and maybe that we should relate to this little short passage of Scripture. First, we'll look at the fact that with that word adoption, that God does not control us, but loves us. C.S. Lewis wrote that the Christian does not think God will love us because we are good, but that God will make us good because he loves us. And that's the simple fact. God doesn't control us. And many times people have that misconception, though, that a relationship with God means restriction. Restrictive and demanding, even to the point of oppressive. But that's certainly not true. God commands us to do things, certainly, but they're not unreasonable. Look with me in verse 15. He says, "For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father." We've not gone, it's not like you're going from one type of bondage to another type of bondage. That's certainly not the case. God's not over-controlling. He's not unrealistic in his expectations. But I would rather think of him as a loving motivator for us, just like we would be for our children, or maybe a niece and nephew if you didn't have children. But you tried to encourage and motivate your child to do their best in whatever they undertook. And that's the same way with God. He's a loving motivator. It's not the fact that we have standards to follow. It's the standards themselves that people get hung up on and have trouble with. That's what we see the contradictions today. That's why we hear, and I think it's important for us to say this in our churches. I think it's important that we say it in our workplaces. And I think it's important that we say it around our dinner tables. The events that have happened in this past week, it's something that's a little scary for me to see, that they're tearing down monuments that they declare as symbols of hate. And I'm not defending a monument. But I have heard Christians being symbols of hate as well. They have removed the Ten Commandments because they did not tolerate alternate lifestyles. Don't think that it was anything else, okay? Because it was a reminder that God has standards. And the assault on these restrictions of God's standards is what we're talking about here, the expectations he has. I think President Trump said it pretty well. He said, if we're going to tear down the statues of the Confederate generals, when will we tear down George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, referring that they were, in fact, slave owners themselves? And if we're able to allow a group of people, a very small group of people, to dictate what is acceptable for our society, how long will it be before a very small group of people will be able to dissent enough to say Christians no longer deserve free speech either? And we are restricted. So it's not God's fact that he is restrictive. It's his standards that are restrictive to sin. And that's what people have a problem with. That's where the control lies. I can't have fun anymore. I can't go out and do what I desire to do anymore. And it's not that God doesn't want us to have fun. I don't think that's the case at all. I think he desires us to have fun. He wants us to be happy. He wants us to enjoy this life that he's put us here for. He just wants us to stay within the parameters of what his word says. And that is something that does not conflict. You can do that. So he's not controlling. He loves us. And we understand that those standards are just like the rules we had growing up at home. Because he wants what's best for us. Psalm 145, verse 9 says this. It says, "The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all of his works." All of his works is us. We're included in that. And he wants to give good. And he wants us to be happy. He's not mean-spirited. He's not a puppet master up there that decides that somebody's going to be miserable and somebody's going to be happy. That's not who God is. That is not what the Scriptures teach us about. He's a loving Father, just like any loving father in this room, that wants what's best for their children. Are there rules? Sure. Are there standards that we have to live by? Yes, there is. Are there expectations? Absolutely. But just like any aspect of our lives, we face those same things. Don't we? There's rules when we go to work. There's rules when we go to school. Our bosses have expectations of what we should do at that work. We don't get offended by that. We don't walk off of our job and go sit under a tree and eat acorns the rest of our life, do we? We comply. God's no different. So God, just a reminder, God does not control us, but he loves us. Secondly, I want to look at the fact that God, and many people, you'll hear people say this, God is not distant, but he is close, but people think that he is. But the fact is, God is not far from any one of us. He's not far from any one of us. They believe that he's not accessible. Some people teach that. Some churches teach that God is only accessible in a limited fashion through limited people. But that's not what the Scriptures teach me. That's not what Christ came here for. He came here to open up that accessibility to all. Look at verse 15 with me again. The last part. It says, "You have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." Now that word in Aramaic is a word that would be used like daddy or papa. And that to me describes a very close, intimate relationship. And I think it's important to realize that that word was specifically used there so that we could understand how close that relationship is and how close God wants us to relate to him. And what he desires for us in our relationship with him. He wants us to have that kind of respect. He doesn't want us to be at arm's length. He wants us to be in his arms. He wants us to look to him and come to him. As the scripture Jesus said, "Come to me, all ye who are weak and heavy laden." That's not something that sounds like somebody that wants to push you away. Go away, kid, you bother me, kind of thing. That's the opposite of that. God is close. We should realize and understand that, encourage people to understand that his closeness really depends upon how close we want to be to God, not how close God wants to be to us. I seen a sign on a marquee at a church over Corbin that said, "If God seems far away, guess who moved?" Well, it wasn't him. It was us that moved. He desires to be close. Thirdly, God does not reject, but affirms. God cares for us as his own children so that we can entrust all of our concerns to his wisdom and love. He cares for us just like we are his children. Why? What are we studying? Are we heirs to God? That's what the scripture just said. What? And joint heirs to Jesus. So therefore, we can entrust him just as a father. He doesn't reject us. Now, the best example I can think of in the Bible for someone that should be rejected at some time, but never was, in fact, was given a great deal of responsibility in the early many times did Peter say or do something that he really, really goofed up? But what do we find when Peter and Jesus are sitting on the beach right before his ascension? When they're frying fish there together, he reminds Peter, yes, I know you failed in the past, but I have a job for you to do. Feed my sheep, feed my sheep, feed my lambs. That's a good example for us to remember. Verse 16 is what I want us to look at. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Here's an example that you can be sincere in your faith, sincere in your relationship with God, and you are, in fact, going to trip, stumble, goof up, say things wrong, do things wrong, sometime or another. I think Peter gives guys like me a break. It lets me off the hook. I don't have to be perfect. And you don't have to be perfect. And I got news for all of us. We're not going to be perfect. We're going to goof up. It doesn't mean that it disqualifies us from serving God. Not if we're sincere. You know, if we make a mistake, what I'm saying now, qualify that, I guess. I mean, we can disqualify ourselves through certain actions. But if we make a mistake and we're sincere when we repent, he's going to take us back just like our kids. Kids goof up. Kids do stuff wrong, say stuff wrong. They make a mistake. We discipline our children. They learn from it and they move forward, and we're happy. All happy and all the better off for it. Through the Holy Spirit, God confirms this relationship. He confirms his love. He confirms the fact that I know you're going to goof up sometimes, but you're still a joint heir to my son Jesus, who I loved you so much, I sent him to be that sacrifice so that we could be joined together. And he affirms that through the Holy Spirit and when we're guided by the Holy Spirit. Now, we're also moved by the Holy Spirit or directed by the Holy Spirit. So that less times we find ourselves tripping up or making a mistake or goofing up because we let the Holy Spirit guide us. And that's when we usually get in trouble. When we take it out of the hands of God and put it in the hands of ourselves, that's when we're most likely to make a mistake. So certainly never discount the power of the Holy Spirit to guide us. He'll reveal God's will in our lives if we allow it. And he'll affirm our relationship with God the Father as a Father. So remember, God doesn't reject us, but rather through the Holy Spirit, he affirms that we are his. Which brings us this morning to our last point in verse 17, that God does not withhold but gives. And verse 17 says, and if children, then heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Now, you think just a second. How many has a joint checking account? Okay. Then you get the concept, don't you? You both can withdraw from the same account. Hopefully you're both depositing. You got more income than you got outgo. But you get the concept that you're able to do that. And that's what we have to realize, that when we become a Christian, we enter into a joint account in the same way with God, a joint heir with Jesus Christ, an heir to God, a joint heir, a joint on that account in the same fashion as well. Everything God owns, we now own. And what does God own? Everything. So that's pretty good, isn't it? That's a pretty good setup for us. God does not put a carrot stick out in front of us. You know, you've seen the old cartoons where they have the old the old mule with the straw hat on and a stick stuck down in its harness with a carrot dangling off a string out in front of it where it'll try and just walk endlessly to get that. But that's not God's plan. What God has in mind for us is not that carrot on a stick that we can never reach. Because it is attainable. Because we have the faith and the trust that when Jesus said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go there to prepare a place for you, and if I go, I will come." That's not a carrot on a stick. That's a promise. That we will occupy heaven someday as a joint heir to Jesus Christ, receiving all the blessings from God Himself. And that's what we need to be affirmed. And that's what's so important about this word adoption. In the same manner that we would treat a child as we would treat a natural born child, God will treat us as being adopted into the family. Gary talked about whenever we were going through the communion service about the covenants with Israel. But what Jesus is talking about and what we're talking about here is that we are joint heirs with all. We are all God's people when we're covered by the blood of Christ, when we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior. He doesn't withhold from us. He gives to us. We share that inheritance. And He holds nothing back. Evidence of that, if I was going to hold something back from somebody, I would have not sent my son down to be a sacrifice. I would have figured out some other way. If I was going to withhold something from mankind, my creation, I would have done something else. So what have we talked about adoption? And what have we learned about the character of God? Because this word adoption has such great power. Is that God does not control us, but rather He loves us. And God is not some far away at arm's length Father, but He's close. And if there is not a closeness in our relationship with God, it's on my part and not on God's part. Because He desires intimacy with us. And God does not reject us when we goof up, but rather He says, affirms us by saying, "You're mine. Feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me?" That's how He affirms us. Just like we would a child. He knows that we're going to make a mistake. Let's learn from the mistake. And then finally, God does not withhold, but He gives. He gives to us, and He is willing to give us even right up to and including the life of His Son. We have to see that change in our life when we realize how much God does love us. Just like that orphan child, when they're adopted, their whole life changes. They're no longer uncertain about where I'm going to sleep tonight, where I'm going to eat, am I loved, am I going to get a hug from Mom, does anyone really care? And we're the same way when we're out there, when we're without Jesus Christ as our Savior, when we don't have any hope for the eternity, we are an orphan. Spiritually, an orphan. But God is saying, "I am willing to adopt you into my family to where you are no longer an orphan, no longer without hope, no longer without love, no longer without a future. I'll give you all of that." And that's why this word adoption has such great power. So this morning, as we stand here, we only have two kind of people in this room. We have those that have been adopted and those that are still orphans. And I'm going to ask you this morning, if you're an orphan, God wants you to be part of the family. We want you to be part of the family. You do that by having heard the gospel that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And once you hear that, you believe it, and you're convicted of that to the point where you say, "I need a Savior, I need to repent of my sins," and you will claim Jesus as that Savior publicly with confessing Him as such. Then you follow him in the example of his death, burial, and resurrection through baptism for the remission of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit that we talked about as a guide. And then you move forward in a joint heir of Jesus Christ until either Jesus returns to take us back to those many mansions or until we're called away in death. So I invite you as we sing, Lord, I'm coming home. That's a neat occurrence. It happened last week with the opening scripture. And it happens today with our hymn of invitation. God wants to give you a home. He wants to give you a permanent home that no one can take away from you. Will you accept that invitation?